Awesome, everyone, class one.
Okay.
What do you do, Bethany?
We should, we was talking some people with you.
Yeah, you want to meet with
you?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Go on, William, what are they going to talk about?
Pets.
Animals, well done, good boy. Right. And I'm going to leave them to introduce themselves because there's three names and I'm not looking at
Thank you, miss. Well, my name's Paul, and I've come along today with my friends Susanna and Bronte at the back there, and we all represent the Blue Cross. Has anybody heard of the Blue Cross before? Fantastic. Would anybody like to tell me what the Blue Cross does?
Remember.
It's okay, I do that lots of times. We're going to talk about that today. That's certainly what we're going to do to begin with. But anybody tell me what the Blue Cross does at the moment, as of today? Yeah.
Is it like
talk about? Again, that's what we're going to talk about today. But as a charity, we're a very old charity. We began life in 1897, our charity. And we look after animals. We're going to talk about animals in war today, and we're going to talk a little bit about safety around dogs as well later on. But the Blue Cross at this moment in time, we help to look after animals, and that's our main job, okay? And we do that, we have animal hospitals. So for people in particular that might struggle to pay for veterinary care, for their dogs or cats, they can bring them to us and we can help treat them. We also help to rehome animals as well. So sometimes people may become ill or unwell and they can no longer look after their animals, and they'll bring them to the Blue Cross and ask us to find a new loving and caring home for them. And we have centres around the country that help us to do that. Can anybody have a guess at what type of animals people ask us to rehome?
Dogs.
Dogs, absolutely, yes. We rehome dogs.
Cats.
Cats, we rehome cats. Ooh, it's very unusual for us to get squirrels, to be honest.
Rabbits.
Rabbits, we do rabbits.
Elephants.
We don't often get many elephants through our doors, no. But we do get one larger animal that you might be aware of, yeah?
Horses,
yes, well done. We have two equine centres and we help to rehome horses as well. And the third part of what we do is, that's part of what I do. And I'm very lucky because I get the chance to come and talk to children in schools about the Blue Cross. So we help to look after people's animals by caring for them and treating them. We help to rehome animals. And we also get to go and tell children about what we do and how to look after pets safely as well. Now today, we're actually talking about animals in war. So what day is it today?
It's the 11th of the 11th.
It's the 11th of the 11th. And what day do we call that?
Remembrance Day.
Remembrance Day. Well done, we do. And today we remember those who served in the wars, both wars that have in the past and people who are involved in current conflicts as well. Now we're going to talk about how we support animals in wars, and particularly in World War I and in World War II. Now, in the First World War, in particular, there were lots of animals involved in the war. Now I'm going to give you three choices. And can you put your hand up? I'll give you the three choices and then put your hand up when I ask which one you think is the right answer. Now, there were lots of animals involved in World War I. The answer A is 4 million animals. Answer B is 8 million animals. And answer C is 16 million. So if you think there were 4 million animals involved in the First World War, put your hand up now. If you think there were 8 million animals involved in the First World War, put your hand up now. We have a few takers, okay. And if you think there were 16 million animals involved, Well, for those of you that put your hand up to the last one, 16 million, you were all right. There were 16 million animals, so very well done. That was a great answer. Now, can anybody have a guess at what types of animals in particular were involved in World War One? Yes. Has it gone? Go on, my friend. Dogs were involved in the First World War, yeah, quite a lot of dogs. Go on there.
Lions.
Oh, not many lions, perhaps, I don't think, in the First World War, yes.
Horses,
great answer. Lots and lots of horses. And the third one in the main. Now, this is quite difficult. We'll see if anybody can get it. Well done. What a fantastic answer. Absolutely. It was pigeons. That was superb. Thank you. So there's 16 million animals used. Horses, mules and ponies, and there were an awful lot of those. And again. Dogs, we've mentioned. And pigeons as well. Okay. Now, in this picture here, I hope you can see at the back, we've got horses. Anybody tell me what the horses are doing there at all? Well, that is one of the things that they did. They carried soldiers and they transported them, and they also transported injured soldiers as well. In this particular picture, they're doing something a little bit different, yes?
Are they putting carriages?
They are carriages, and the carriages contain guns. So they pull carriages containing guns, they transported people as well, and they had another important function in the First World War as well. They carried food and supplies, yeah, absolutely. But in the First World War, they actually carried troops and cavalry soldiers in the First World War. If you move on again. Now, we mentioned dogs before. Could anybody have a guess at what this dog's actually doing? It is jumping, you're quite right. It's jumping over a trench, in actual fact. But it's got something around its neck, if you look there. It's a collar and it's got something attached to it. What do you think might be in that? Yeah. Well, not quite, no.
Is it a message?
It is, fantastic answer. It's a message. And dogs were used to carry messages. They were also used to carry first aid equipment. They helped to detect mines. And they also helped to dig people out when there'd been an explosion. People might have been buried in the soil. And another job that they actually did, which I was really surprised at, was they helped to lay communications cables. So, like that, that dog's got a collar there, it would have a pack attached to its back, and as it would trot along, it would unravel telephone wire and it would lay cables. So how clever is that? Okay. Now, we mentioned pigeons. Okay, and what do you think pigeons did? Now, you mentioned it before, so yeah? Yeah, fantastic. Yeah, they provided message. Obviously, dogs could carry message. Pigeons have the advantage of flight, and they could travel a lot further. Now, again, as with the horses and dogs in the war, they suffered particularly because they got often stuck in mud. They had to deal with the bombs and the gas that was around. And pigeons, well, quite a lot of pigeons actually got shot, or even when soldiers were very, very hungry, they actually got eaten as well. Okay. Now, the Blue Cross in particular, we raised money both at home and abroad to help raise funds. And we supplied animal ambulances, and we also provided veterinary hospitals over in France, and we treated, in this case it's a mule, and we treated horses, mules and ponies and dogs, and by the end of the First World War we treated over 6,000 animals, and many of those animals, the vast majority, were made better, and they went back into serving in the war. So the Blue Cross raised money at home, and we provided equipment to help the horses, so blankets and other equipment that helped them, and we also supplied our animal hospitals over in France as well. Okay. Now, the Second World War, well, things were a little different, and there weren't quite as many animals used in the Second World War, and for our help, it took place largely on home soil in Britain. What do you think these ladies are doing here? Yeah, they are helping the dog. The dog's not very well there, and I think it must have been quite difficult because they're working by candlelight, aren't they? And that must have been pretty tough for the vets and the vet nurses that help those dogs out. One of the other jobs that we did in the Second World War was, what do you think this lady's doing here? Anybody guess? Yes, go on. Yeah, she is. She's trying to find something. You can't see the picture very well there, but here, there is actually a cat. And you can imagine, in the war and bombs had fallen, and homes and factories ended up like this in rubble. And it was obviously very scary for the adults and the children, but do you think the animals would be scared as well? Yeah, absolutely. And what do you think the animals might do if they were scared?
They will run away.
Yeah, they might hide or they might run away. And often what happened was that when people were looking through bomb sites like this, initially they would look for obviously the human casualties, but then afterwards people and volunteers from the Blue Cross could actually look for animals that may have been injured or who had run away. And this lady is rescuing a cat, and hopefully that cat would have come to us and it would have been taken care of and found a new home. Okay. Now, what I didn't ask you at the start was how many of you in the hall actually have a pet yourselves? Quite a lot, okay. And what type of pets have we got? We'll just ask for a few. What have you got at home? What pet?
A dog.
A dog. Okay, what's your dog called?
Hamish.
Hamish, fantastic name.
A cat.
You've got a cat, and what's your cat called?
Twinkle.
Twinkle, what a lovely name.
Dog.
And you've got a dog, and your dog's called?
Bella.
Bella, right, super names. I won't ask any more for the moment, but if you go perhaps on holiday, and you don't see your dog or your cat or your hamster or your gerbil for a week or so, do you miss it?
Yeah.
Yeah? And when you come home, what do you do?
Look after it.
You look after it. You might give it a big hug, perhaps, yeah? And food, yeah. You can feed it as well, absolutely.
I'll give it some presents.
Oh, you might bring it a present back. Well, if you can imagine, these people here, and we have a sailor here, and we have three gentlemen who were serving in the army, and they might have been away for a long, long time overseas. So how do you think they look? How do you think they felt when they came back and they saw their animals again? Yes. Yeah, I think they felt very happy. You can see that they're obviously, they've missed their dogs a lot, and they're showing it a lot of love and affection there. And so it's the same as us. If we come back and we've missed our animals, we'd probably give them a big hug too. Now, one thing that we did is we actually rewarded animals for their bravery. Often you'll see soldiers and they may have medals, and that recognises their efforts of bravery in conflict. And we actually had our own medal. And a quick story about this dog, and this dog was called La Cloche, and actually La Cloche was on a boat, and the boat was attacked, and there was a sailor. He went overboard and he couldn't swim, and La Cloche saw that the sailor couldn't swim, and he dived into the sea, and he kept the sailor afloat until somebody could come and rescue him. So they got the sailor back onto the boat, and he was safe and he survived. But they couldn't see La Cloche afterwards, and they wondered what had happened to him. Anyway, a while later, somebody looked out and they saw a dog actually stood on a plank of wood in the sea, and they went and rescued him. And in honour of his bravery, we gave him a medal. and his bravery was recognised. Now, you may not be able to see this at the back, certainly, but this medal says Blue Cross, but above it, it says Our Dumb Friends League. And in actual fact, although we're called the Blue Cross now, we began life as our charity, as Our Dumb Friends League. We changed our name after the Second World War, and we changed it in connection with the wars, actually, because on the battlefield, if a human was injured, people put a flag in the sand, and it had a cross upon it. Did anybody know what colour that cross would have been, and they still operate today?
Cross.
It's a cross, what colour?
Blue.
Not this for humans?
Red.
Red it was, and you hear of the Red Cross, and they still help people in war and conflict today. If it was an animal that had been injured, people put in a cross, and it was a blue cross, and that's how they denoted which was an animal casualty, which was a human casualty. And there's our blue cross, and we still do help pets today. Now, quickly before I go, I said at the start we'd talk a little bit about safety around dogs. Now, some of you have got dogs in the room, and now some of you may have these types of dog, I'm not quite sure, but could you tell me, do any of these dogs look dangerous at all?
No.
No? Yeah, well, this one, the Shih Tzu up here, looks quite cuddly. Yeah, the poodle looks very playful. Well, the answer to that question is actually that all of these dogs could be dangerous. Okay. So, all dogs, given the wrong or the right circumstances, could be dangerous. And I'm going to just tell you a little bit about how to be particularly safe around dogs. Okay. Now, don't approach a dog if he is... What do you think we should not approach a dog when he's doing certain things? Yeah.
Eating.
Good one, yeah.
Or drinking.
Drinking, fantastic. That dog's drinking there, yeah. Anything else?
Sleeping.
Yeah, well done.
Sleeping.
Sleeping, feeding, drinking. Fantastic answers. You got them all at the one go. Superb. We always say, don't remove his or her toy. You can imagine if you're playing at home, you've got your favourite toy. If somebody came along and they grabbed it off you, would you be happy?
No.
Exactly. Well, your dog might not be happy either. And what can your dog not do that you can do? Speak. Your dog can't tell you that he's a bit unhappy, so the only way he can perhaps tell you that is to perhaps growl, or sometimes actually bark, or even snap. Okay. Now, I know nobody in this school would ever do this, but some people actually do. But we always say never hit, kick, or smack, or be cross with a dog. Okay. And also, it's important that when you're out and about, that if you saw somebody walking down the street and they had a lovely, cuddly-looking dog, would you rush over and give it a big hug?
No.
No, quite right, okay. You'd always ask the owner, really, and see what the owner said. Listen to the answer. It might be that the dog is very friendly and you can tickle it under the chin and that's wonderful, but you wouldn't go up and give it a big hug because it doesn't know you. Imagine if you were walking down the street and some stranger came up and gave you a big hug. What would you think? That'd be strange, wouldn't it? Okay. Don't run or jump around dogs, in particular that you don't know, because you don't know how they're going to react. Okay, and it might frighten them. Don't scream or squeal around a dog. Some dogs are particularly bred to chase things, and particularly when they hear a screaming or squealing noise, they associate that with something else and they might come and chase. And give them plenty of room, as they might feel what? If you are sat in a corner room, you're not bothering anybody, and some children come up around you, what might you feel? Yeah.
Quite annoyed.
Annoyed, yeah. Crowded, you would?
Claustrophobic.
Claustrophobic, yeah.
Cross,
you could be.
No space to...
You've no space, you're quite confined, and you might feel a little scared as well. Okay, next one. And again. So, you could also be out and about, and you might be in a park or a field, and sometimes you might get a dog that's off its lead, and it might come bounding over to you, and it might be very, very excited. Okay. Now, if that happened, what might you do? Do you think? You said don't run away. Yeah, well, that's a very good answer. You're quite right. Because if you run, the dog thinks, well, that might be a really good game. I'm going to carry on chasing you. And crikey, you think, well, how far can I run? Because it's going to catch me up. Sorry? Well, yeah, not go near it. That's a good thing. But the dog might be coming towards you because he might be very interested. Could I have a volunteer, perhaps? Yes, I think your hand went up there first. Okay. Now, we'll all get the chance to practice this in a short while, but we'll demonstrate firstly. Okay, so if you're out and about and a dog comes bounding up towards you, we've said don't run, that's absolutely right, but what we usually tell people is to stand very still, as tall as you can, to fold your arms, and to not look at the dog at all, so to look away. Now, I'm going to practice something very shortly, and we'll see how we do. Now, we haven't got our own dog to bring today, but we have our Blue Cross dog, which is Doobie. And we're going to use Doobie for this exercise, just to give a quick demonstration. So Doobie is our very excited dog. So remember what we're doing. We're standing tall, we're folding our arms, and we're looking away, okay? So Doobie's bounding along, and he's coming up towards you, and he's very interested in you like this. He's very interested in you, but you're looking away, and you're doing very well. And that was an excellent demonstration. Thank you very much. A big round of applause. Okay. So stand still, tall, look away, fold your arms. Dogs love to chase, don't run away. Great answer. If you have any food or toys, they might be interested in those. So if you have a McDonald's burger, it might be a bit hungry. So drop that, and the dog might well go and eat that and leave you alone. And finally, if you are actually knocked over, then the best thing for you to do is to curl up very small, okay, and put your hands over your face to protect your face, okay. So could we all stand up? Okay, now I want you all to practice being very tall, folding your arms, and looking away. Okay, and I'll look around now, I can see that we're all doing it properly. That is super. You can all sit down again now. Very well done. That was an excellent demonstration. And I've got to say, you've been absolutely super. You've come up with some fantastic answers.